Hello students, how are you? Fine doing? Great. So, welcome to the new academic year 2021. It has already started on Friday, but it's the new beginning for me and for you for the physical chemistry classes. Right, students? Are you all ready? Are you all there for the class? Please, I want a record break. All of you, all the students should be there for this class, students. So nobody should miss this class. I hope all are ready with your physical chemistry notebooks. Right, students? Okay. And one important point, students, I want to thank God for keeping you all and me also, my family, to stay safe, sound and healthy during this pandemic, students. And also, I want to ask God to help you and me to move on this new academic year for your studies and for your health, for your families, for your siblings and also your parents. Okay, so may God help us to start this new academic year and the new physical chemistry classes, but old afiyaman. Fine, okay, right. So what is that chapter that we are going to begin, students? I told you previously, two, three days back, I uploaded a video of the topics from dilute solutions and colligative properties. Hope you all noted all the topics, right? Right, students? Okay, very good. So before starting, I want to tell you something, students. Please, you can comment in the comment section or the comment box that how you are feeling. So looking at me, how you are excited to listen to the physical chemistry classes. Anything like a positive comment, you can comment in the comment section. Please don't do any negative comments, students. Okay, so right. Ready? Okay. So here to begin with, students, dilute solutions and colligative properties. Okay, so this is the unit that we are going to start with in this academic year 2020 and 2021. Okay, students, right now. So before going into the chapter, I want to ask you something. Okay, so all of you, you'll be having sugar and salt, the common ingredients in your kitchen. Are you cooking? Have you cooked something, tried cooking something at home, students? Have you ever helped your mom in these 3 or 4 months at home? So, very good. Some of my girls have helped your moms in cooking. Okay. And all my greetings to your parents also, mama and papa, all your sibling students. My question is, suppose you take one full glass of water. Now itself you can try. Take a glass of water from the kitchen and one small spoon of sugar or salt, anything whichever you like. Okay, you take it and try to dissolve in the one glass full of water, students. What happens? Will it dissolve? Did it dissolve, students? I think some of the students are trying this at home. So one spoon salt or one spoon sugar and one full glass of water. So try dissolving it in the glass full of water. Did it dissolve, students? Very good. It gets dissolved completely. Now it looks like a single solution in the glass. Okay, so we cannot see now that spoon of sugar or salt in the glass of water. Okay, so only a clear solution we can see. That is called as a homogeneous mixture of two or more substances. Here we have taken only two substances. What are they, students? Sugar, water, or salt and water. Okay, now we prepared a homogeneous solution using these two substances. Fine, students. Okay, now we say this homogeneous mixture of salt and water, or homogeneous mixture of sugar and water, is called as a solution. Okay, so in our topic, students, in our heading, there is a dilute solution and also colligative property. First, I want to begin with the solution. Put the side heading solution, students. Okay, so what is a solution? A solution is the homogeneous mixture, spelling HOMOGENEOUS. Homogeneous mixture of two or more substances is called as solution. Got it, students? Written down the definition. A homogeneous mixture of two or more substances is called as a solution. Okay, so we have taken sugar plus water or salt plus water. Okay, so we have taken how many components, students? 1 plus 1, total 2 components. Okay, so now we prepared a solution taking sugar and water. Okay, so we could prepare a homogeneous mixture which is called as a solution. Now, this solution made from two components is called as a binary solution. Okay, students, binary meaning is two components. A solution made of two components is called as binary solution. Okay, one more example I want to give you. 95% alcohol. What does it mean, students? It means that 95 ml alcohol plus 5 ml water. Okay, so this is also, that means 95% alcohol is made up of 95 ml alcohol plus 5 ml water. So how many components are there? Again, two components are there. So this is a binary solution. Okay, got it? Now, so but what is the difference between the two components, students, in all these solutions? What is the difference? The difference is one component is in smaller quantities and the other component is in larger quantities. Okay, so we have taken 1 spoon salt or 1 spoon sugar and 1 full glass of water. Okay, so one component is taken in smaller quantities and one component is taken in larger quantities. Okay, so now the component taken in smaller quantities is called as solute. What is it, students? S-O-L-U-T-E. It is called as solute. What is it? The component. Kindly write down, students. Don't miss any point. The component taken in smaller quantities is called as solute. And the component taken in larger quantities is called as solvent. Very good. Is called as solvent. Okay, students. Now, solute is the component which is taken in smaller quantities. Solvent is the component which is taken in larger quantities. Clear, students? So, this is all we study under solution. Now, tell me, if we take water, we can dissolve many number of substances in water, right? You all know that. So, what is water called as, students? As number of substances dissolve in water, what do we call water as? Right? You know the answer. Right. It is called as universal solvent. What is it, students? It is called as universal solvent. Why? Because most of the substances dissolve in water. Hence, we call water as universal solvent. Okay. But there are also substances, students, which does not dissolve in water. Okay. So, the solutions which dissolve in water are called as aqueous solutions. What is it, students? The solutions of substances in water are called as aqueous solutions, and the solutions of substances in other solvents are called as non-aqueous solutions. Okay, so number of definitions we have come across, students. Solution, homogeneous mixture of two or more substances. What is solute? The component present in smaller quantities is called as solute. The component present in larger quantities is called as solvent. Okay? When a solution contains two components, it is called as binary solution. Very good. Okay? And why water is called as universal solvent? Because many of the substances are dissolved in water. And aqueous solutions, solutions of substances in water, underline, are called as aqueous solutions. And non-aqueous solutions, solutions of substances in other solvents, okay, are called as non-aqueous solutions. Clear, students? Am I clear? Hope I am clear, right? Next. Now, let us see what dilute solution is. Put the side heading, dilute solution. I am writing here, students, dilute solution. So, in the beginning of the class, what did you do? You have asked your mama, 1 spoon sugar and 1 full glass of water. Okay. Now ask your mom, same glass of water, 1 more glass, not this solution. Okay. So 1 full glass of water again, and ask her half the glass of sugar or half the glass of salt. Okay. Then the solution prepared from such quantities, we call it as what, students? It is called as concentrated solution. Okay. But suppose you take full bucket full of water and add little amount of salt or sugar, then it is called as dilute solution. Okay. So what is the component present in smaller quantities called as, students? It is called as solute. What is the component present in larger quantities called as, students? It is called as solvent. Okay. Now, so what is dilute solution? Dilute solution means in which the solute is present in very, underline this word, very small quantities. We call it as a dilute solution. Okay, students, got it? So dilute solution means the solution. Write down the definition. Please write down the definition, students. We are not in the classroom, so I have a big blackboard and I write the complete sentence. Please write down in your notebooks. The solution in which solute is present in smaller quantities is called as a dilute solution. Okay, shall I repeat once again? The solution in which the solute is present in smaller quantities is called as a dilute solution. Okay, now I will show you 2 little diagrams, students. I have taken 2 beakers. Okay, so in 1 beaker, this is water. Okay, so we call it as pure solvent, students. Pure solvent. Okay, and this is water. Water plus salt. That means, or water plus sugar, whatever it is. A dilute solution I have taken. Okay, 2 beakers. One is pure solvent, the other one is dilute solution. Now you know what dilute solution is. Okay. So you must be shouting in the house, right? What is dilute solution? The solution in which solute is present in smaller quantities. Very minute quantities, students. Okay. Now in this dilute solution, the solute particles will be one here, one here, like this. So what did you understand from this? So now this is the solution. Okay. Now solute particles are few in number. So they are distributed like this. That means I am now in Secunderabad. Your house might be in Tolichowki. One of you might stay in Medipattam. One of you might stay in Vijayanagar Colony. One of you might stay near Old City. Like that, we are far apart. So, not that much far apart, students. Just it's an example. So, the solute particles in a dilute solution, what is it, students? The distance between them is very high. That means they are far apart. They are not close to one another. Okay, so as they are far away from one another, the attractions and repulsive forces between the solute particles in a dilute solution. Remember that, in a dilute solution. Why? Because the solute particles are small in number. Okay, so when a dilute solution is prepared, the distance between the solute particles is more, and hence we say the attractions and repulsions between the solute particles will be very, very less. Okay, students, so when you are asked to write what dilute solution is, you should be able to write these points. Clear? Am I clear? Okay. So, from our topic, dilute solution is also over. Next, what is remaining? What is remaining? Colligative property. Put the side heading, colligative property. Colligative property. So, what is a colligative property, students? So, I might have my own characteristics. So, students observing me, listening to me, might possess different characteristics. Like that, taking this dilute solution, it also, I cannot say it has characteristics, but I can say it has some properties. Okay, so the properties of dilute solution, students, they depend on the number of solute particles. Okay, I told you solute in a dilute solution will be in minor quantities. Keep that in mind. Even if you wake up in the middle of the night, you should be able to tell this. Okay, in a dilute solution, solute will be very, very less. And the properties of dilute solutions, they depend on the number of solute particles, students. Okay, but not on their nature. Okay, I am erasing this diagram, students. But not on their nature. But not on their nature. Okay, so the properties of dilute solutions, which depend on the number of solute particles, but not on their nature, are called as colligative properties. Got it, students? Write down the definition. Okay, so start writing. The properties of dilute solutions. Write down the properties of dilute solutions, which depend on the number of solute particles, but not on their nature, are called as colligative properties. Okay, colligative properties. So do you remember, students, you have studied this colligative properties in the intermediate? Do you remember? Yes. How many colligative properties are there? There are 4 colligative properties, students. There are 4 colligative properties. And also, students, one important thing. This colligative property is mainly used to determine molecular weight of a non-volatile solute. What is it, students? It is used to determine molecular weight of a non-volatile solute. Now tell me, what's the meaning of non-volatile? Non-volatile means, right? It's a very correct answer. You are very much right, students. Non-volatile means it cannot be evaporated. It is not volatile. For example, you can write down NaCl. Okay? So, in order to determine the molecular weight of a non-volatile solute, we use colligative properties. This is the main important feature of colligative property. Okay? So, write down this point also, students. Fine? Now, the 4 colligative properties. Number 1, write down, students, lowering of lowering of vapor pressure. Okay, the first one, lowering of vapor pressure. Second one, elevation in boiling point. What is it, students? Elevation in boiling point. Third one, depression in freezing point. Depression in freezing point. Okay. Fourth one is osmotic pressure. Okay, students. Fourth one is osmotic pressure. Write down, students, all these. I will give 2 minutes time. First one, lowering of vapor pressure. Second one, elevation in boiling point. Third one, depression in freezing point. Fourth one is osmotic pressure. Okay, please kindly write down, students, all these four. Okay, written. Okay, now, so I'm erasing these 4 points. So let us start with the first colligative property. What is it, students? The lowering of vapor pressure. Put the side heading, Roman letter 1, lowering of vapor pressure. Lowering of vapor pressure. Put the side heading, lowering of vapor pressure. Right? Okay. Are you ready, students? So first, lowering of vapor pressure. So what should you know first about this? About which point you should know, students? We should know about vapor pressure. Now tell me, what is vapor pressure? What is vapor pressure? Okay, so you might have uttered or given the answer at your houses. Okay, I am sure that you must have given this answer. The pressure exerted by vapor is called as vapor pressure. Right? Am I right? 100% right. But I will give only 1/4 mark for this. Okay, this is 6th class answer. So tell me, students, when exactly we say or we see vapor coming out? From where will the vapor come out, students? From a simple common example, from any liquid we can see the vapors coming out. But when will the vapors come out from the liquid? Suppose you are sitting near the dining table at your houses. Okay, so there is a glass of water or a bottle full of water. Open the lid and see. Can you see any vapors coming out from that liquid, from that water, students? No. When will you see vapor coming from a liquid? You take that water, okay, pour into a bowl, put it on the stove, turn on the stove, okay. After some time, we see vapors coming out from the liquid, right? That means you are applying or you are subjecting it to some temperature or you are heating the liquid. Okay, so then only we see the liquid converting into vapor. Got it, right? So this is the answer. And what the correct answer that you are supposed to write for this vapor pressure. So now, students, liquid is heated, vapor is coming out from the liquid. What is the meaning of this vapor is coming out from the liquid means what? The liquid particles, they reach to the surface, then they exert some pressure, and this pressure exerted by the vapor when it is in equilibrium with its liquid is called as vapor pressure. Okay, simply if you write down, ma'am, the pressure exerted by the vapor is called as vapor pressure, why you did not give marks, means you will get only 1/4 mark. You should write all these things. at a particular temperature, the pressure exerted by vapor when it is in equilibrium with its liquid is called as vapor pressure. Okay, right? So write down the definition for vapor pressure, students. Write down: at a particular temperature the pressure exerted by vapor when it is in equilibrium with its liquid is called as vapor pressure. Okay, now suppose if you heat the liquid more and more, then what happens? More and more vapor comes out of that liquid. More and more vapor coming out of the liquid means more and more pressure will be exerted by the vapor. Okay, so that's what we say: vapor pressure increases with increase in dash. What will you write in that dash? Increases with increase in temperature. Okay, correct, good. So next, now what is lowering of vapor pressure, students? Vapor pressure, now okay, now you know what vapor pressure is. Now what is lowering of vapor pressure? Again we will take two beakers, one beaker of pure water and one beaker of a dilute solution. Okay, so dilute solution, you all know, solute particles are far apart from one another. I'm writing here, students, write down here. Pure solvent, for example water, and this is dilute solution. Okay, dilute solution. Now we'll try heating the solvent and we'll try heating the dilute solution. Okay, so you all know, here this is only water, students, you can try at home also. So when you heat this pure solvent, what happens? Slowly, after some time, the solvent particles from the bottom, they reach to the surface. They're reaching the surface means they are converting into vapor, students. Okay, it's being converted into vapor. Vapor is forming means it's exerting pressure, which is called as vapor pressure. Clear? Now, come to our dilute solution. See, dilute solution, we have seen solute is present in smaller quantities, and also that solute is a non-volatile, students. Okay? Remember that, non-volatile, that means which is not evaporated, which cannot be converted into vapor. Okay, so in this dilute solution, when you are trying to heat this dilute solution, so what solvent particles have to do? They should come to the surface, right? But as the solute particles are there, here and there, in this beaker, what they do, you know, students? They obstruct the solvent particles from reaching to the surface. Okay, so they do not, or they hinder the solvent particles from reaching to the surface. Okay, so what happens? Only few solvent particles, they reach to the surface, students. Here all of them are coming nicely to the surface. But solution, all the solvent particles, they are not allowed to come up to the surface. Why, students? Because the solute particles, they are hindering, keep this in mind, they are hindering the solvent particles from reaching to the surface. When they don't reach the surface, students, remember, they cannot be converted into vapor. When it is not being converted into vapor, no pressure. So few particles are reaching to the surface, students. Okay? So the pressure exerted by these particles also will be, what is that? Vapor pressure will be less. Here it will be more. Simple concept, students. Simple concept. Pure solvent, more vapor pressure. Why? When you are heating the pure solvent, most of the solvent particles, they reach to the surface, convert into vapor, exert pressure, which is vapor pressure, which will be very, very high. Clear? Dilute solution. The solute particles, they hinder the solvent particles from reaching to the surface, and hence only few solvent particles can escape to the surface. That means the pressure exerted by few solvent particles will be less. Okay, hence we say vapor pressure of a dilute solution is less than vapor pressure of a pure solvent. Got it? Suppose if we denote vapor pressure of pure solvent as P naught and vapor pressure of dilute solution as PS. Write down in your notebook, students. Vapor pressure of pure solvent, denote it with the P naught. Okay? Vapor pressure of dilute solution, denote it with the PS. Okay? Which one is greater? Which one is greater? P naught. Very good. So P naught is greater than PS. Okay, you know the reason now. Fine. So this is vapor pressure of dilute solution. This is vapor pressure of a pure solvent. This is more than this one. Okay, this is more than this one means, my language you should understand. This is vapor pressure of pure solvent. This is vapor pressure of a dilute solution. Okay, now suppose this is 10 mm students. This is 8 mm. This one is greater now. Okay, now. Lowering of vapor pressure means, carefully listen students, P naught is greater than PS. Then what is lowering of vapor pressure? So how will we know from this lowering of vapor pressure? The difference between P naught and PS at a particular temperature is called as lowering of vapor pressure. Got it, students? The difference between vapor pressure of pure solvent and vapor pressure of a dilute solution containing a non-volatile solute is called as lowering of vapor pressure. Written? Please kindly write down the definition, students. Lowering of vapor pressure. Most frequently this question is asked in the exams, students. So write down the definition carefully. Once again I am repeating. At a particular temperature. At a particular temperature, the difference between vapor pressure of a pure solvent and vapor pressure of a dilute solution, containing non-volatile solute is called as lowering of vapor pressure. Okay, students? Written? No, right. Now, this lowering of vapor pressure. This lowering of vapor pressure is denoted by delta P. Okay, what is it, students? Lowering of vapor pressure is denoted by delta P. So remember, delta P means it is called as lowering of vapor pressure. Okay, so now how to write the expression for delta P? It is equal to P naught minus PS. Now tell me, what is delta P, students? Delta P is lowering of vapor pressure. What is P naught? Vapor pressure of pure solvent. What is PS? Vapor pressure of dilute solution. Okay, so why did we write P naught minus PS? Because P naught is greater than PS. Okay. So delta P is equal to P naught minus PS. Put it in a box, students. This is the expression for lowering of vapor pressure. Okay. So always P naught, that is vapor pressure of pure solvent will be greater than vapor pressure of dilute solution. Okay, and also I have given you the reason for this, because in a dilute solution there will be solute particles which will be hindering the solvent particles from reaching to the surface. That means only few of the solvent particles reach to the surface. That means only a few particles, that is few solvent particles, will be converted into vapor, and the pressure exerted by these few solvent particles will be less. That's what we say, vapor pressure of a dilute solution is very very less when compared to vapor pressure of a pure solvent. Okay, so this is all about lowering of vapor pressure, introduction students, and in the coming classes we will be seeing or will be learning this lowering of vapor pressure is explained by Raoult's law students. Okay, is explained by Raoult's law. So this we will be continuing in the next class. So that means in this from this Raoult's law we will be learning how to determine the molecular weight of a non-volatile solute from lowering of vapor pressure using Raoult's law. Okay, so today what did we learn students? We have learned what a solution is, what a binary solution is, what a solute is, what a solvent is, why water is called as an universal solvent, what are aqueous solutions, what are non-aqueous solutions, what are dilute solutions, and what is a colligative property, and how many colligative properties are there, and what is the main important use of colligative properties. And also students, we have started the first colligative property, that is lowering of vapor pressure, under which we have learned what vapor pressure is, what lowering of vapor pressure is, and how the vapor pressure of pure solvent is greater than vapor pressure of a dilute solution. Okay, and lowering of vapor pressure is denoted by delta P, and vapor pressure of solvent is denoted by P naught. Vapor pressure of dilute solution is denoted by PS. Okay, and the expression for lowering of vapor pressure is delta P is equal to P naught minus PS. So this lowering of vapor pressure we will be learning from Raoult's law. So, and next after this students, we will be learning about the experimental determination of lowering of vapor pressure using Ostwald Walker's method, and also after this we will be doing some numericals based on this. So like this, four colligative properties we will be learning in the beginning. Okay students, am I clear? So if you have any doubts, please post your write down your doubts in the comment section. Okay, clear? So any doubt, anything you can ask me, I am ready to explain. Hope I have made this introduction clear to you all students, and thank you very much. And one more important thing I want to tell you, please mark your attendance in the comment section along with your complete name, group and roll number. Okay, so once I note down all the attendance, immediately I will be removing the attendance students. Don't worry about that, but within the before 11 a.m. itself you should be posting the attendance. After 11 a.m. you are not allowed to post the attendance students. Okay, so clear? So all the students from both the sections, please write your complete name, section and also roll number. So don't miss, and also I expect 100% attendance, because if there is 100% attendance, I will be immediately letting academic dean know about this, and immediately she will be informing sister principal, who will be very happy for you students. And I also feel very happy, and in the coming weeks also I expect the same from you students. And please, please write down all these points and read first. Okay, so meet you in the next class with a new topic students. Thank you.